Well, hello Internet, and welcome to part one of my microservices in production tutorial series. Today we are going to look at blocking versus reactive. My name is Imran Yusupov, and I have worked as a software architect on microservice architecture for the last several years. And now let's see what exactly I mean by blocking. As you know, that is probably the architecture that most of you are familiar with. The application server has a limited number of threads in their connection pool. Usually that is 200 threads for Tomcat, and for some of the other well-known application servers, it might be slightly different. And those threads are responsible for retrieving requests from the client. And the servlet container or the servlet thread will pass this request to the third-party dependency, such as database or some subsystem. And until there is a response from your dependency module, this thread is blocked and the thread is not able to proceed another request. And this architecture actually works very well if the dependency system responds quick enough, usually less than under 10 milliseconds. But if you have some latencies in your dependency, this architecture and this blocking fashion of your application server threads will no longer be scalable. And now let's look at what is reactive or non-blocking. In reactive or in non-blocking architecture, the requests are sent to an event loop, and from where they are passed to your subsystem, and until the subsystem renders a response, the thread that initially created this request is not blocked, and it is free when the request is sent to your subsystem, and it is able to retrieve or respond to another client's request. And this makes a huge difference, especially when you have dependency system failures or latencies. And now let's look at a real example with a proxy microservice and a sluggish submodule. So recently we had a proxy microservice that goes to a core system, which is a monolith, and brings some data from the core system and aggregates it and returns to the client. To simulate the behavior, I have created a Spring Boot application, which is called core system. And what is special about this core system or this application is that I'm able to pass a slowness parameter and create some artificial delays on the API that it exposes. And this is the proxy microservice under discussion. And to make matters worse, in our case, we had to make multiple threads, like multiple trips to the core system, usually 5 to 10, and bring some data and aggregate it and return to the client. And there are two APIs. One is called Quick, which absolutely doesn't do anything. It creates a new instance of the card object and returns to the client. And the other API, which is called From Core System, makes blocking trips to the core system, and it actually makes 10 trips and returns the data to the client. And this one is in blocking mode. And the other API, which is called Reactive, is doing the same, but it returns a flux, and it is also making 10 trips and aggregating the results and returning to the client. So now let's create a stress test on this system and see how the blocking and non-blocking calls will behave compared to each other. In the first iteration, I'm just calling this Quick API multiple times, and this API has nothing to do with the core system. It just creates a Java object and returns to the client. And as a result, it should always respond very quickly, usually in several milliseconds, and it should almost always respond under 10 milliseconds. And now let's create some load tests and see how the system will behave under stress. I'm using 100 threads and 1 second as the ramp up period and loop count as infinite. So when I hit this start button, you will immediately see a huge CPU load on the application servers GVM activity in JProfiler. And you can see a lot of threads are in waiting mode. Some threads are in network IO, and also some threads are doing real work. And there is some garbage cleaning activity. Overall, the system is quite loaded. And if you go to the throughput of the system, we can see something close to 45,000 requests per second, which is extremely good and which is what we expect from a highly scalable application. And the most interesting and important piece here is that the system is constantly able to produce the same amount of throughput in the response. And now in the second iteration, I will include the subsystem core system call in our load test, and we will compare how it will impact the whole stress test. So in this iteration, I have included this subsystem call in our load test, but still a lot of requests are made to the Quick API, and only one request in each iteration goes to the subsystem. We are creating a load test with 100 threads and with the same configuration as we made in the previous iteration. And now let's create some load and see how the system will behave. And as soon as we start, you can see there is almost 10,000 requests per second, which is a very good throughput. And there is a CPU usage activity in the JProfiles monitor. But after several seconds, you will see it will stop and it will become sluggish. And at this point, the CPU usage will go to absolute zero. And after several seconds, the CPU usage will increase again, and you will see some activity here as well. So we can immediately conclude that even so it is able to produce a huge throughput, it is no longer predictable. And there are some delays after several seconds without any reason. And if we are using Kubernetes and we are dependent on CPU usage activity as our auto-scaling factor, that will no longer behave as we expected, as when we need the performance and throughput the most, we will never see the auto-scaling working, as the CPU usage will almost always be zero. And now let's introduce some sluggishness on the subsystem, and I will use 500 milliseconds and see how the system will behave. Obviously the throughput should drop, and you can see it has dropped to a very low number, and also the CPU usage has dropped, but probably you expect that the CPU usage should increase. But the reason of that is that almost all of our threads are in network IO. And now let's go to the APIs and let's call our proxy API, which makes 10 trips to the subsystem. And obviously 10 trips times 500 millisecond delay, it should respond in 5 seconds. And let's call this API and see how it behaves. You can see the response time is even higher, at close to 10 seconds. And now let's call this Quick API. And the Quick API doesn't have to do anything with the subsystem, and it should respond again under 10 milliseconds. But you can see it's no longer predictable. Also, it is responding in 2 seconds. And that is the whole point of blocking fusion of the application server architecture. As a single point of sluggishness in your microservice architecture can propagate to other layers, and they can impact your APIs that has nothing to do with the subsystem. And that is because at this point, all of your threads in your connection thread pool of your application server are in network IO, and they are blocked by the subsystem API call. And if we reduce the sluggishness on the system to zero, let's make it zero again, you will see immediately the CPU usage will increase, and the number of threads that are in network IO will drop. So as you can see, with blocking architecture, your microservice infrastructure no longer is predictable and is not scalable as it is used to if there is some sluggishness on your subsystems. This time I am calling the reactive API, and I have excluded this blocking API call from our load test. And the reactive is doing the same, exact the same thing. It's making 10 trips to the subsystem to bring some data as its blocking counterpart. Again, a lot of requests are made to this quick API, and we are using the same configuration, 100 threads, 1 second ramp-up period, and infinite as loop count. Now let's start the load test and see how it behaves. You can see there is a very nice throughput in the output of our summary report, and it is higher than the blocking API calls. But, and also you can see very good CPU usage activity in the JProfiles monitor. And the interesting part here is that, the most interesting part here is that the system is constantly able to produce the same throughput. And there is no longer the sluggishness in every 30 seconds or so as we had in the blocking call. And now let's introduce some sluggishness and slowness on the subsystem. Again, we will add a 500 millisecond delay. And obviously the throughput should drop now. And it is still very good compared to what we had in blocking API call. It is close to 500 compared to what we had, like 7 or 10 requests per second in blocking call. And still the CPU activity will drop even in blocking API calls when there is some sluggishness on subsystem. But very interesting point is here. If we call this quick API again, you will see it's almost always responding under 10 milliseconds as the sluggishness in our subsystem is isolated and it doesn't propagate to this API that has nothing to do with the subsystem. And even more interesting piece is here, this API, which goes to the subsystem and makes 10 trips and aggregates the data and returns to the client. In blocking API call, it took 10 trips times 500 milliseconds, close to 5 seconds. And we can see here, it will take around 5 seconds if we make a blocking call. And even higher. But if we call this a reactive endpoint, you will see it will respond almost 5 times quicker. And the response time is now close to a second and 200 milliseconds. So as you can see, when the subsystem is sluggish, the blocking architecture is no longer predictable and scalable. And this point, what is when we should consider reactive? And these are some of the production experiments that we did. And by using this reactive endpoint, we were able to increase the output and predictability of our proxy microservice. I hope you enjoyed this video. Hope to see you in our next video series. Thank you very much for your time.